Actually, that's the first time I'll be talking about this particular topic outside of Würzburg, which only appeared lately in our research. And I think it fits right in this conference, even though it might be dealing with a physical manifestation that is not so much in the focus of your contemporary research. The type of states you want to stabilize are very much at the focus of this conference, namely these topological band structures and manifestations thereof. What I want to tell you today is an attempt to use electrical circuits to become the host for topological band structure analogs in such electrical circuits. And that's what we call topoelectrical circuits. And maybe it will prove interesting to actually find a new direction for stabilizing such topological band structures. In the 20 to 25 minutes given, I'll shortly talk about the conceptual point of view that people have taken in the past 3 years, 3 or 4 years or so, to actually think about classical systems and how they might be able to provide host materials or host systems, host design systems for topological band structures. Then I'll give you the formalism, the theoretical formalism to think about electrical circuits in terms of band structures, which is the essence you need in order to appreciate how to translate a topological band structure into an electrical circuit or vice versa. And then I'll show you some examples that we've already communicated in our first paper on it, or in the first posting on it, namely the Suchry-Verhiger circuit in one dimension, and I'll show you experimental results for that as well, the what we call zigzag circuit in 2D, and the Weyl circuit in 3D. So let me start with where the field is right now. I think if you start with the founding of topological band structures, quantum Hall effect, 2D quantum spin Hall effect, 3D topological insulators, you might be tempted to say that the driving mechanism for such topological band structures is usually of quantum nature. I'm saying that because everything in this case centers around t squared equal minus 1, which is just the essence of a spin 1/2 associated with the electron. So you might say that from that viewpoint, the topological states of matter that people have thought about might be uniquely tied to a quantum environment. Well, this is not correct, or it's not complete at least. It's a sufficient condition, but not a necessary condition. And I think among the first papers to point this out was a paper by Kane and Lubensky, published late December 2013. They realized that in mechanical systems, you can actually get topological boundary modes that remind ourselves from the edge modes that you would get in a topological insulating environment. There's a lot of differences, but again, the main feature is the same, namely that you might have some spatially constrained boundary response that is not dependent on local modifications of the system, but is tied into the system as a consequence of its topological band structure features. Since that paper actually took a while for this field to take off, I would say, but by now, in the last 2 or 3 years, in particular when it comes to phononic systems, optical cavities, resonators of similar kind, quite some range of experimentally accessible systems has arrived and has been accomplished in order to see topologically insulating band structures in environments that would not be just standard materials of electrons with spin 1/2. For example, we have these mechanical oscillators and topological bands of phonons, which is sort of which is the direction I feel that is most directly connected to this paper by Kane and Lubensky, but there's also photonic circuits that people have thought about, and also cold atomic gases. The Zach phase has been accomplished lately in a cold atomic gas environment. This slide is not, I borrowed this slide from Hans-Peter Büchler, who concerned himself a lot with this direction, and just to give you one I would say, quite nice video of what Sebastian Huber in Zurich has accomplished. He has coupled pendula, so sorry for the light. You can, might not be able to see it nicely. It's a YouTube video, so you can watch it online. He can actually define a coupled set of 2D pendula where some boundary mode propagates just along the boundary, well, that's why it's called boundary mode, along the boundary of the sample, but not into the bulk, and features at least some boundary character that we would know from one-dimensional edge states of topological insulators. You can put this on more rigorous footing, but the basic bottom line is already here and explicit in that picture. So let me then ask, okay, what is the current shortcoming of that field? So I think I want to make two remarks here. The first remark is they have only talked about topologically insulating states, but not about topological semi-metallic states. And one major statement of ours that I think can also be transferred to these mechanical system, photonic cavities, whatnot, is actually that we can extend this formalism to have classical realizations of topological semi-metals and not just topological insulators. That's the first statement. The second statement is actually visible from this enormous experimental setup that they have. Mechanical degrees of freedom are always hard to treat. It is not particularly versatile in terms of dimension. Tuning that system actually demands a lot of effort, and the degrees of freedom that you can play with are actually very limited. You don't have a polarization degree of freedom. The type of elements you can put into coupled pendulas is very limited. So I think in many, many respects, electrical circuits is exactly what we need in that sense, because all these shortcomings of previously studied classical systems will be remedied by this type of approach. So the circuit band structure is the essence for you to connect to electrical circuits. You know all well how to think about topology in terms of a band structure. What I need to tell you is how you can convert an electrical circuit into a band structure. As soon as you have that, basically we can start discussing the actual electrical circuits on the basis of what you know and what you have mastered in the past 10 years research-wise. And for that, let me start with most elementary notation that we'll be talking about. At this stage, let me constrain ourselves to just RLC circuits. So the only circuit elements that actually matter will be capacitors, inductors, and serial resistance that is unavoidable as a matter of principle. So in this particular example that I show you here, you have three nodes in the electrical circuit. That would mean that the basis of what we will be talking about is three-dimensional, and we will be distinguishing a circuit ground matrix. The circuit ground matrix just contains all the different components that are contacted to the ground. In this particular case, the first node, let me call it entry one, is connected to the ground via an inductor. This is why you have this entry in the circuit ground matrix. Then you have an adjacency matrix that just asks how are the nodes connected. In this particular case, the first node here is connected to the second node through a capacitor. This is why you have the capacitances in here. And then the second and the third node is connected both through a capacitor and a resistance. That's why you have capacitors and resistance in there. In addition, I want to look at a third matrix that I need to define, the total node conductance. It's just counting whatever flows out of a given node, and in this particular case, aside from the grounding, and in this particular case, this looks like that. Well, this is the formalism, and I hope I was clear enough. So for every finite size electrical circuit, you will have a matrix representation that is as highly dimensional as the number of nodes in the circuit. And you can basically write down the connectivity of the different nodes by looking at the different circuit elements that you have. It's really similar to a band structure in that sense. What is, of course, different is that you have a driving current, external current, which always enters by this omega, but we'll come to this later. The essence of this whole system is basically given by Kirchhoff's law, which is just saying that the current is conserved, that flows into a node and that flows out of a node. From there, you can basically already understand that what we're really talking about here from a purely theoretical standpoint, that's just a comment for the theoretical audience, is a graph Laplacian. This is really what we talk about. So we don't have interactions here, but we can define a Laplacian as an operator on any accumulation of points, and certainly on a graph like that. This is really the essence of it. So how can I get you to a continuum representation of this graph Laplacian? This is really the theoretical phrasing of what I'm doing here. So for that, we define the grounded circuit Laplacian J. The Laplacian by itself is defined as D minus C, so total node conductance minus adjacency matrix. And then the grounded Laplacian is literally defined as matrix D minus matrix C plus matrix W. And this is, if you wish, the eigenvalue equation that we want to consider further. So now, how do I make a continuum version out of this? This is very trivial for a material. When you have different sides of atoms, you're very intuitive about how to make continuum operators out of this. Here it works very similarly. You take the current and you define a current density, you associate a current density with it, and then by imposing the conductivity relation, J is sigma of E, and similar to the gradient of some potential difference, you find the continuum Laplacian L as just being the eigenvalue operator, if you wish, connecting a current profile with a potential profile. And here already you see that there's just continuum operators mathematically imposed on the problem, and this is basically the essence of what you need to know. You have the eigenvalue equation, current is equal to some grounded Laplacian J times a potential profile, and we solve this problem, of course, by inverting, by solving the inverse and inverting J. But now, just for the moment, let me just connect it to a Schrödinger equation, if you wish. So the wave function would be a potential profile of the circuit, and the eigenvalue, the energy, would be the eigenvalue of the Laplacian, which is something like the inverse impedance associated with a certain eigenstate. This is really what this equation means. So you're basically enumerating the eigenpotential modes that, by some eigenvalue, connect to a current profile through the circuit. This is what you do, and then you solve this problem just by defining the circuit Green's function. That is standard material for condensed metaphysicists, and you can actually connect this Green's function form to a physical interpretation by looking at this inverse expansion carefully, and what you notice is that essentially the Green's function measures the following. If I have a Green's function between a node A and a node B, you go through the whole circuit and you count every path it can possibly take through the circuit and see what contribution that gives to the Green's function. So this is what this equation makes very explicit. Now, of course, you can write the Green's function, as always, into this bilinear form. This doesn't have to be Hermitian, but as long as the circuit is reciprocal, it is. It's interesting to look at non-Hermitian systems, but I'll come to that later. Let me just for the moment assume that the circuit is reciprocal. So this would just be a standard Hermitian Green's function profile, and the eigenvalues of J accordingly enter as 1 over Jn. Now, and you can look at our paper to see the very elementary calculations. They are not very complicated. The first experimental observable that I want to talk about that you can get from there is the impedance. The impedance then actually turns out to be a sum over all eigenvalues of this grounded Laplacian, which is the difference of the potential eigenmodes at node A for some given n minus the potential eigenmode value at node B divided by the Laplacian eigenvalue. And what you can see from this expression here is that, well, there's one unfortunate thing. It sums over all eigenvalues. But imagine we manage to get a Laplacian of some form where there's some low-lying eigenvalues of this Laplacian. Then the whole impedance profile is dominated by these low-lying eigenvalues. And a very elementary measurement of impedance can give us an idea of what the dominant modes are. And this is really what we have. Those will be the edge modes of the topological band structures we're talking about. Okay, so let me show you some results. let me start with the Sue-Schrieffer-Hegar circuit, which is the simplest one. Let me define two parameters of the problem. One is the ratio of two capacitors, C1 over C2. I call that T. And there's some eigenmode frequency. I call that 1 over square root of L times C1 plus C2. The schematic plot of the circuit is like this. You have an alternating chain of capacitors C1 and C2 that reminds you of the polyacetylene, where you have a double bond and a single bond between carbon. And these are the two hybridization elements. And this is how the grounded Laplacian matrix would actually look like if you write it down. But all this chain is grounded through an inductor on each node. And then let's have a look at the impedance profile of this problem. So when I choose a parameter t that is smaller than 1, I get a huge impedance peak at this eigenfrequency omega twiddle. If I choose t larger than 1, this is completely gone. Well, you would all know what that means. In one case, we have the Sue-Schrieffer-Hegar midgap states for t smaller than 1. And for t larger than 1, these midgap states are gone. So for t smaller than 1, the system is in the topological non-trivial phase. And for t bigger than 1, it's in the topologically trivial phase. And well, that sounded appealing to us. So we actually tried to make this proposal more accessible, even more accessible to experiments. So this is a little modification of the plot that you saw before. These red dots just denote the nodes, like the different sites, if you wish, of the system. Like in condensed matter language, we would be talking about sites and not about nodes anymore. And then we do one thing. This is the impedance measurement we want to make. Like we have an external voltage source that goes into the circuit, like with some current I, and the current I comes out here. So that's the impedance measurement we want to make. But then at the same time, we have two correlated switches here, here, and here. And what these switches really do is they change the boundary condition of the Sue-Schrieffer-Hegar circuit. So either we have C1, C2, C1, C2, C1, C2, or we have C2, C1, C2, C1. What this actually does is it transforms the parameter T to 1 over T. So that's a very nice way to experimentally switch from the topologically trivial regime to the non-trivial regime, just by a switch, just by modifying the boundary condition of the system. The other thing that I plotted up here is the eigenstate of the Sue-Schrieffer-Hegar midgap state as a function of the t that I defined before. So if I normalize it with respect to the first potential change having the value 1, it actually goes on like, okay, potential difference from here to here, no potential difference here, and so on. And the functional form is 1, 0, minus t, 0, t squared, 0, minus t cubed, and so on. So, okay, so we posted this paper early May, and I gave a talk to the Molenkamp lab 1 week later. And some subgroup of the Molenkamp lab got so excited that they immediately wanted to put this into their lab. So we decided to wait for the first experimental results on that particular circuit. This actually worked. This is the circuit here. This is the team that did this. And so let me show you the results. They are like 1 week old. So bottom line is exactly how the experimental results exactly match the theory. As I told you, with the switch, they can switch between T. In this case, we picked capacitors such that the ratio is 0.2, so it's deep in the topologically non-trivial regime, and the trivial regime just by changing the boundary condition. And you see the impedance measurement as a function of just changing the switch. So you have like this huge peak that comes from 1 over J. Because J is small, there's a huge peak in the impedance when the midgap state is present, and it basically vanishes when you change the boundary condition of the system. But even further, just by looking at the voltages here, you can basically map out the eigenstate. You can map out the eigenstate of the potential just by measuring the potential changes. And this also works perfectly. So this is what the plot is showing to the right, is measuring the absolute value of the potential difference, and to the left, the actual phase that comes along with it. As you see, for every second non-zero value, the phase has to change by pi. So there's a minus one shift. And as you can see, this is true. And within error bars of the experiment, this Sushrifa-Heger eigenmode is exactly measured as the potential differences along this circuit. So I think this is really, I'm quite amazed by it. Okay, so this is how, as far as experiments have come so far. We are currently incorporating the experimental results into the first paper submission, such that we can aim for a decent journal. So let me now come back to theory proposals that we have also reported on before, namely exploiting one central feature of these topoelectrical circuits. They're not constrained by dimension. People talked about the zigzag edge in graphene a lot. Well, this is just the zigzag edge in graphene recast as a topoelectrical circuit. If you look at the band structure of that circuit, you see the half-filled flat band of that is reminiscent of zigzag graphene. You can also ask what would be the consequence of the impedance. And of course, the impedance will be huge along this edge now, because you not just have one mid-gap state, you have an extensive line of mid-gap states that all locate at very low Laplacian eigenvalue. So the impedance is completely determined by that signal. So it's extremely, it can be observed in a very stable fashion experimentally. That would be how the impedance profile looks like. So let me be a bit quick and actually connect to the previous talk where people asked the question of how to engineer wire materials. Well, in an electrical circuit, that's what I wanted to say. You're not constrained by dimension. The electrical network, how many neighbors you have and whatever, you're the one to decide. It's the perfect design system for any dimension of lattice you want to create. So this is the Weyl circuit that we have. And this Weyl circuit should feature Fermi arc density of states. You see, the jargon is a bit mixed up because we're adopting language from the quantum electronic world. But actually, spectral-wise, not eigenstate-wise, but in terms of the spectrum, this is just in one-to-one correspondence. And this is very conveniently realizable in an experimental setup. You just need conductors, you just need inductors and capacitors. And we also did a disorder analysis. If you buy capacitors and inductors from IBM or so, then they give you some variance of the capacitor and the inductor. This would be the analog of disorder in a system. So you have to address the question, how susceptible is your proposal to disorder? And just to make that story short, the topological semimetals are extremely, extremely robust to disorder because you have such a huge, extensive amount of low-lying impedance contributions that it doesn't make much difference. That's the bottom line. Let me finish by realizations, by generalizations of the system. I think, hopefully I'm not overstating it, but I think this might open a new field and it might give you ways of designing topological states that don't have a band structure analog. You can certainly play around with domain walls in the circuit. You can go to four-dimensional topological insulators if you like. Doesn't make a difference on the network. On the network, you can have eight neighbors. And you can look at quasi-periodic topological states that has also been in the focus of recent research. So, already at this conference, we started discussing with our friends like some other projects that one can do along this direction. So I think there will be more coming up soon. So let me thank the research team. The theoretical work has been done with Ching-Hua Li, who is now in Singapore, who was previously a PhD student in Stanford with Xiaoliang Qi, Stefan Imhoff, Christian Berger, and others from the Molenkamp lab, and with Tobias Kiesling being the main contributor to the particular electrical engineering of these circuits. Thank you very much.